Hello, welcome to my talk, Routing on Rails with OpenStreetMap. First of all, this talk will not be about Ruby on Rails. It will be about routing with Java and Grasshopper on OpenStreetMap railway tracks. My railway router, which I have programmed at GeoFabric over the last few months, is not the first railway routing engine which exists. There are also other solutions, for example, Dravik by Geops, but this is a proprietary railway routing, or railway routing solutions by Menz, a supplier for information systems of various German transport organizations, but this is also a proprietary routing. But there are also open source-based solutions, for example, Raildar.fr. It's doing its routing with OpenStreetMap routing machine, but rumors say that it uses OSM filter and some kind of tag replacement to replace the railway tags by highway tags. A newer OSM-based solution is signal.eu.org, also a French project, which supports the distinction between the left and the right track on railway lines with two tracks. It also avoids unnecessary reversing of trains. So now about the railway data in OpenStreetMap. The railway data in OpenStreetMap, the railway tracks are connected, so you can do routing on them. There's usually one way per track, except in areas which are not mapped very well. Then you have tracks equals two tag on the track, if there are two tracks for one way in OpenStreetMap. There are currently 1.8 million kilometers of tracks on the whole world, a little bit more than 600,000 kilometers are in Europe. There are 1.2 million possible points and more than 600,000 possible points in Europe. Possible points means that these are locations which might or are railway points, but they are not tagged as such. Only 290,000 of them are tagged as railway switch on the whole world. Simple points are mapped like this. We have the OpenStreetMap data is shown in blue in this image, and the rails are shown in black. You have just two ways connected with a common node. It becomes a bit difficult if it's a slip point, for example, this double slip point, where you can turn from this track to this track or just continuing on straight on. Then you need to add an additional tag, railway colon switch equals double slip. And for single switch, for single slip points, there's a different tag, and I recommend to add a turn restriction to indicate which turns are possible and which not. Because in this example, it is not possible for a train to change direction from coming from here to there, because there's no switch plate here for the curve. Railway crossings are easier to map. They are just two tracks sharing a node, and the tag railway equals railway crossing. This is almost all report important for the routing. There are tags for the railway tracks. The railway key is the most important. It's giving information which type of railway we have. If it's a normal rail, it's a light rail, tram, etc. The gauge tag for the distance between the rails. If the track is electrified and which type of electrification is available, the voltage and the frequency. I've given a more detailed talk about this at Sodom in Brussels. Check out the video on YouTube if you are interested in it. My railway routing is based on the Grasshopper library. It is adapted for the special needs by the railway operations. For example, it supports power systems. If a routing profile is only designed for engines which support only one power system, for example, 15 kilovolts, 16.7 hertz, then it will only use those tracks which have the matching tags in OpenStreetMap. It supports gauges, so you cannot use the router to route from Paris to Moscow, except your train supports both the European and the Russian gauge. It comes with a free pre-configured profiles, one for freight trains and one for and a few TGV profiles for high-speed trains for the to be used in France and the German-speaking countries. There's a universal profile for diesel trains on any gauge with a speed limit of 120 kilometers per hour, and there's a profile for a universal electric train, even if it does not exist. It supports any power system at any gauge, and it's 140 kilometers per hour fast. You can write your own profiles using a YAML configuration file. Just add a few lines to the graph hopper configuration file you would use if you would route on roads. The routing does avoid unnecessary reversing. Instead, it will make a detour if that is faster than reversing the train. It has reduced default speeds for crossover and other slower tracks. So it will not use the shortest route through a station, but it will use the fastest route. And it offers map matching for CSV and GPX input and output files. Now I come to the demonstration. For example, if I would like to route a TGV train from Paris Est Oh, that's the map matching, sorry. To Frankfurt. And that's the route for TGV, and that's the route if we don't use a TGV train but a regional train which is not as fast and therefore prefers the old line via Saarbrücken. This is a high-speed line via Strasbourg. It's a little bit faster. And there's also a map matching available for GPX and CSV input files. For example, this is a measurement on a train I did a few months ago, and that's the result. The original measurement had a lot of gaps in tunnels, and Graphhopper closes these gaps and matches the measurements on the railway track in this narrow valley. But you can also use it if your GPX input data has only a few points. For example, the route from Karlsruhe to Milan. It's taking a bit longer to compute, and that's it. It had only about 1,000 points in between in the original input data, and you can also save it as GPX file. Some words about the performance. I recommend to filter the input data before you run Graphhopper. It's very fast to use Osmium text filter. It needs 6 minutes on a fast server and only a little bit more than 1 gigabyte of RAM for the whole planet to filter out all important railway data. Just all nodes and ways tagged with railway equals anything. The result is a 168 megabyte large OSM PBF file. The import takes with Graphhopper 1 minute and needs 1.2 gigabyte RAM without contraction hierarchies. I'm currently using Graphhopper 0.11 pre-release version, which does not have or has contraction hierarchies, but in the past conduction hierarchies were only supported without turn restrictions. The resulting graph is 204 megabyte large, and to compute about 2,500 routes to Germany, you need 2 minutes and 8 seconds with one single track. In this example, I sampled 100 train stations in Germany and computed the routes between them. The average length of the route was 409 kilometers. Now about implementation. My first step was to derive a class from the graph hopper OSM class, and later I modified the cleanup method to add my turn restrictions at all points. A flag encoder is also simple to implement. You just derive a class from the abstract flag encoder class and override a few methods, for example, accept way. As I said, the routing can be configured using a YAML file, and these are the keys to use in the YAML file to configure the routing profile. The name, which types of electrification are supported, the voltage, the frequency, the gauge, the max speed, and the speed factor. It is also possible to do routing for trains which support multiple electrification standards, for example, the German and the French power systems. My experience with Graphhopper, it is suitable for routing on any routable OSM network. So you could also use it to route boats on waterways if the waterways are connected. The introduction into writing your own flag encoder could be a little bit more verbose. The turn cost extension had nearly no good documentation, which led to a misconception by myself. I fixed this by improving Graphhopper. There are no different penalties possible for the reversing of a vehicle if you use multiple different flag encoders. So if you want to do both freight train routing and routing of passenger trains with the same Graphhopper instance, or both of them need the same penalty for reversing, but in reality, these penalties should be different. A passenger train needs about 10 to 15 minutes, sometimes only 4, while a freight train needs 15 to 60 minutes. Graphhopper seems to be designed as a library for car routing only. The flag encoders were designed to be extensible, that's the good point. The addition of turn restrictions was not so easy to extend, and the reading of OpenStreetMap raw data files is not extendable at all. That's why I had to fork Graphhopper for my purposes. A good point is it has a forum, and if I didn't have a question on the forum, but existing questions already answered my questions. I recommend to read the unit tests if you do some such strange things as myself. Now I'll come to the end of my talk. There's still left space for improvement. My routing does not distinguish left and right tracks on double track lines. For example, in Germany, trains are running on the right track in direction of travel, but in this case, it's a long left curve with crossovers before and after the curve, and that's why the routing prefer to use the left track. There is already support for this in the OpenStreetMap data. There's the tag railway : preferred direction equals forward or backward or both to indicate which is the default direction on the track. It's usually used in Sweden and the east of France, but not in Germany. Also an area where my routing could be improved is the estimation of travel times. It's currently a stupid 90% of the speed limit used, but in fact this leads to too fast travel times. For example, these are two intercity trains in Germany, both running on old lines with many curves. and I underestimate the travel times, even on the quite straight line from Magdeburg to Dessau with almost the same speed limit on the whole line. It is not really possible to avoid unnecessary reversing if you set wire points at all stations. For example, this is a train from Saarbrücken to Frankfurt. This train does usually not reverse in Mannheim Central Station. Instead, it uses this railway line to continue its travel to Frankfurt. Gradients are not supported at all because OpenStreetMap is a two-dimensional data set, but this is important for freight trains because freight trains have difficulties with large inclines and are not able to use this railway line shown in this picture. The problem is the SRTM data has a too low resolution. Cuttings and embankments are not visible in the data. Narrow valleys lead to even more problems. For example, if you have a railway line next to a steep hill, then you would get a height profile which looks very noisy, and the vertical precision of the SRTM data is not good enough. Possible solutions are to use the railway lines to correct the elevation data, or to use elevation profiles provided by the operator of the infrastructure, or to measure the elevation profile ourselves. It is also not possible to avoid urban tunnels with diesel engines. For example, this is the tunnel of the Munich S-Bahn. I assume that it is not that you are not allowed to use this tunnel with a diesel engine, but we cannot map this in OpenStreetMap because there are no signs at the beginning and the end of the tunnel. Loading gauge data could be mapped in OpenStreetMap, but it's not mapped very often, and it's sometimes it's difficult to measure because you are usually not having your own train to measure the loading gauge of a tunnel. A solution would be for that purpose to match OpenStreetMap with a different data set and in the flag encoder, so you could read the OSMPPF file and check if the ways intersect with polygons of prohibited railway tracks. I would like to express my thanks to SNCF and GeoFabric for sponsoring the development of this software. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Michael. Very interesting. Other questions?
I have one technical question and one commercial one. Technical one is, I didn't notice that you have these typical profiles like with cars, the fastest, quickest, most scenic, most economical. Do you have this kind of profiles at all?
Well, I currently have only one so-called weighting. It's the fastest weighting, but I do not have a different weighting for the shortest one or for the most scenic one.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's maybe for the future. A commercial one is, how many trains are using this for everyday work?
Sorry?
How many trains are using this for everyday work?
No one, currently.
Any plan to apply it? Or?
Yes, there's a large European railway company which plans to use the software for routing, but not to plan which tracks their train should use, but more to match the current position on railway tracks. And it will not be used for purposes where safety is important.
Just a thought on your speed calculation. You said that you were working it out on 90% of the speed limit. And I was just thinking that trains tend to go a lot more slowly around corners, and perhaps there was a way that you could measure the how sharp the corner was and slow the train down around that section accordingly, and perhaps that would give more accurate results to the timetable results than just the blanket 90%?
I've already got a Perl script from someone else with more precise formulas to use for the calculation of the travel times. But I have not found the time to re-implement it in Java.
Mainly I wanted to say thank you for the detailed feedback about what Graphhopper can and cannot do about the import. There was not a lot we could offer. Forking is basically the only option there. This wasn't really meant to be that extensible. But do you have anything on the algorithmic side where you think you would encounter limits? Like, if, for example, I don't know anything about railways, but are there certain kinds of switches which you can't really model with regular turn restrictions or something? Is there anything there, or is it all very straightforward?
I was able to model the turn restrictions on switches with all everything Graphhopper provided. I had to hack the reading of the OSM input file to avoid unnecessary turns on railway crossings. So at this example here, I edited turn restrictions for this turn and for this turn and the two sharp turns here. And that's why I created an additional set of all railway crossing nodes during the import of the OpenStreetMap input file to add the turn restrictions later. That's what I meant with the OpenStreetMap data import is not really extendable.
You mentioned a maximum speed for diesels of 120 kilometers per hour. That seems very low to me. Is there a reason you've restricted it to that level?
I used 120 kilometers per hour mainly because there are not that much diesel engines in Central Europe who are running faster than this speed.
Yes, I was thinking of things like the Virgin Voyages on the West Coast that are running at 200 kilometers per hour, 125 miles per hour.
Hi, and thank you for the talk. One question, did you take these different security systems in Europe in account, so like EDCS, or in Germany it's called LZB, or this kind, did you take it in account for the routing over Trans-Europe?
Not yet, but I would be able to do it without even forking Graphhopper, because that's just an additional if tag is set in the flag encoder. So it's not planned yet, but if someone wants to write a pull request, I would accept it.
Any other question? Okay. Thank you very much again, Michael. I want just...